past Chief Sully on March 27th, Easter morning. I've never been in the face of death, but you shouldn't have. Generally expect that the first dozen encounter get out of your grandparents, but not one of your friends. A month following that, I went to the grieving process. That explains what that made her look like. Elizabeth Kubler Ross proposed in her book on death and dying that there are five stages of grief, the first being denial and isolation, the second, anger, the third, bargaining, the fourth, depression, the fifth, acceptance. These emotions don't occur in any necessary order, and they can last from hours to years. The stage of denial and isolation can be described as feelings, or it can be described as a way to simply get through the day, as a person who experienced a loss is not yet ready to accept their situation. Anger seems self-explanatory, but can become complicated when dealing with loss. It can give structure to one's emotions. After feelings of numbness and detachment, it can give you a connection to another person, which is often one desires their loss. Bargaining is a way of thinking that the situation could have been avoided. The what if statements, and if all these allow one to become lost in a world of alternate endings. Depression is rather self-explanatory as well, consisting of feelings of intense sadness and emptiness. It feels like it could last forever, yet you're in a rush to snap out of it. Acceptance can be difficult to understand, as it is commonly mistaken for being okay with what happened. Acceptance is fully recognizing that your loved one is not here anymore and learning to live on without them. These stages are not requirements of grieving, however. Everyone responds to a loss differently, so there's no right or wrong way to grieve. These steps are simply patterns in the grieving process that have been observed by psychologists. Their purpose is to allow someone to grieving to make sense of their emotions in a confusing time. My grieving process began before the medical passed. She got sick very quickly after she was given her prognosis and was placed in the hospice care with limited visitors. None of it felt real. Even after she had passed, I felt as though I didn't get the closure I needed. In the span of a month, I had gone from hanging out with her nearly every day to not having her here. As I knelt by her casket and her people, my eyes were being fixed on her chest, waiting to see her breathe. Her chest never rose, but it still felt like she was just a few minutes up the road and I hadn't seen her. I experienced all the emotions described previously and then some. Despite how much I didn't want to believe she was gone, it was impossible to ignore the reality of the situation. I felt detached from my surroundings, like a third person view looking down upon my life. I had no desire to maintain my grades, relationships, and responsibilities. I was angry, but it was a strange feeling. I was unsure of who to direct it at. I wasn't mad at the doctors. They had tried everything they could until there were no more options. And I wasn't mad at God for reasons unknown to me. To be frank, I was mad that I was one of my friends and not some old person who wasn't already on the way out. But who can you blame for that? This results in me in taking out my anger on family and friends and those whom I believe didn't understand my situation, thus isolating myself further. I bargained hard over her death. They caused me to question my faith, but regardless, I begged for God to do something. I didn't know what I wanted from him, just to intervene in some way to change something. My transition into acceptance was slow and gradual. It wasn't like I woke up one day and suddenly was okay with the fact that she was gone. It took periods of reflection and deep grief to make it to a place where I could continue to live normally. Looking back at my situation a year later, it's easier to see the meaning of the grieving process and to make sense of the many emotions I experienced. No matter what, thinking analytically about your emotions is a difficult task, but it's necessary in learning the lessons that grief can teach you. The grieving process requires you to remove yourself from the normal stream of life and take time to reflect the role that you play in your relationships. What I learned from my experience is this. Many of these statements are cliches that I'm sure you've probably heard before a number of times, but there's a reason for that. Unfortunately, you don't always understand the gravity of these statements until you have experienced the loss for yourself. A New York Times article written by Daniel Goldman references how loss will make you recognize the value in all your relationships with friends and family and significant others, and make you reconsider the role that you play in them and in the world. Grief and loss are there to remind us of the importance of our relationships. Connection with more people is all we have in this life. And I'll end it here with a quote by Khalil Gibran. When you are sorrowful, look again in your heart, and you shall see that in truth you are weeping for that which has been your delight.